This is Tuesday, October 15th, 2013. We are in Natick, Massachusetts, and this tape is part of the Morse Institute Library's continuing Veterans Oral History Project. My name is Maureen Sullivan. Our cameraman is
I'm John Hayes.
Okay, and you're John Hayes. Cameraman is Dan McDermott of Natick Pegasus, and we are privileged to have with us today John P. Hayes, Sr. Welcome, John.
Thank you.
May I ask when you were born?
Where I was born?
When?
I was born June 19th, 1925, mm-hmm. in the south end of Boston.
And what town do you currently live in?
In Brockton.
Your marital status?
Divorced.
Do you have children?
I have four wonderful kids.
And how many grandchildren?
Nine.
No grandchildren
yet.
All right. And tell us what the south end of Boston was like growing up.
Well, it was really a hodgepodge. Mm-hmm. The wealthy people had begun to move out, and the, I would say, mostly poor people lived there. Where I grew up, one side of the street was mostly Jewish, the other side of the street were mostly Irish. Mm-hmm. As time went on, I think at one time we figured there were 26 different nationalities. Mm-hmm. And I grew up with all kinds of kids.
Okay. And what did your father do for a living?
My father was a riveter at the shipyard, Four River Shipyard.
And what did your mother do?
My mother was mostly a stay-at-home mom, although she did a lot of housework for other people.
Mm-hmm. And where and when did you enter the military?
I entered in, I guess it was South Boston. Mm-hmm. We were on the line of South Boston and Dorchester. So the draft board was in South Boston. Mm-hmm. And that was in June of 1943.
Were you just out of high school?
Yes, I just graduated.
And from what school?
Cathedral High.
And what was going to high school like in those days?
It was a tough period. Mm-hmm. Knowing that some of the kids that had graduated a year or two before were in the service, a couple of them got killed. Mm. So that made it a little bit rough.
Mm-hmm. And while you were at home during those early days of the war, did your family take part in food rationing and all that?
Oh yeah, we had the rationing. Mm-hmm. My father was an air raid warden, which, that was something, with the helmet and the big stick. And mm-hmm.
Why did you join at the time? Did you join the Army or the Army join you?
No, I had actually tried the year before to join the Marines. Mm-hmm. And they said, with feet like those, you will never march. I was and I am flat-footed to this day. Mm-hmm. But they said, no way. So later, I tried the Navy, and I was underweight. So finally, when I turned 18, I knew I had to sign up for the draft, mm-hmm. and eventually I'd go. So I went down and I volunteered for enlistment, even though I was considered a draftee. Actually, I had papers that I was accepted into the Army Specialized Training Program. And I was supposed to be a radio man in the Air Force.
But?
Well, the Army had different ideas. Today I could sue them, but then you couldn't do that. And I wound up in the infantry. Mm-hmm. I did tell the commanding officer, I was young and naive, that I was supposed to be a radio man. He said, well, we'll give you a radio, be 60 pound on your back. I didn't like that idea. So,
did family or friends join the service when you did?
No, one of my brothers had already gone in.
Mm-hmm.
That was it.
And what was your brother's name?
Ralph.
And
he went in the Air Force.
Did he get out okay?
Actually, he was in this country. He served in this country training and so forth until my ship, coming back from Europe, his ship was going out.
Uh-huh.
So the war was almost over by the time he got over there. He was a photographer in the Air Force.
Mm. Is he still with us?
No.
Ah. Where were you sent for basic training?
Camp Willa, Georgia, right outside of Macon, Georgia.
And how do you spell that?
Willa, W-H-E-E-L-E-R.
And tell us what that was like.
Well, I had 26 weeks of training.
Mm-hmm.
And of course it was very intense. I think, well, the first time, it made a man out of me. With all the exercise, some of it not so much fun, but it really was pretty strenuous.
Mm-hmm.
And after 26 weeks, I had gained some weight, and I think I felt like I was in pretty good shape.
Mm-hmm. Was this your first time away from home?
No, I had spent two or three summers at the Poland Spring Caddy Camp.
Mm-hmm.
And that was a great experience.
Would that happen to be in Maine?
That was in Maine, okay. In Poland Spring, Maine. That was a good experience. Had a good time there.
Yeah. While you were in basic training in Georgia, did you have a chance to get off base and kind of check out?
We were allowed off base if mm-hmm. we could get a pass and go into Macon, mm-hmm. Georgia.
And what was that like?
It was not a bad city. I would suppose today, I would almost call it redneck.
Mm-hmm.
But there were favorite places in town, although they did at one time had a sign up on the grass, soldiers and dogs keep off the lawn. So they kind of told you what we were like. Mm-hmm. We weren't very well accepted.
Mm-hmm. Did you receive advanced or specialized training beyond basic?
No. That was intensive enough.
Okay. How was it determined what kind of training you would receive?
Well, infantry training was mm-hmm. really, we had to qualify on the shooting range with almost every kind of a handgun,
mm-hmm.
machine guns, Tommy gun and so on, and that was quite mm-hmm. intensive.
Do you remember what kind of weapons you were using while you were training?
Well, mainly we used the M1 rifle,
mm-hmm.
and of course we had bayonet training. That brings to mind kind of a funny story, but when we had the training, bayonet training, was orchestrated, the director of it was our lieutenant.
Mm-hmm.
And he and I did not get along too well.
Mm-hmm.
And he came at me as he should have, to disarm me with a bayonet. But when he was halfway, I switched from right-hand stance to left-hand stance, and he was completely off guard, and I threw him down.
Oops.
That was not a very popular thing to do. And that weekend, when we all stood in formation, and he came along to examine us, examining my rifle, he said it was dirty, and I could not have a pass for that weekend. Mm. That didn't sit too well with me. So again, I went to the commanding officer, and I asked him if he would inspect my rifle. And he did, and I told him what had happened. So he gave me a pass to go into Wheeling, Camp Wheeling, and into Macon. That evening, walking down the street in Macon, I ran into the lieutenant and his wife, and he said, "You are not supposed to be in town." And I said, "Sir, I have a pass from the captain." Needless to say, that did not make us get along any better.
Oh dear.
That was one of the fun moments.
All right. Now, hopefully that was the last you saw of the lieutenant at the basic.
Yeah, well, after that, we were pretty much ready to come home.
Okay. You have finished basic. What happened next?
Where is came home on a 10-day leave, and then we went to Fort Meade, Maryland.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, we had some more training for a couple of weeks, and then we shipped out to Camp Patrick Henry in Virginia, and that was our POE.
POE standing for?
Port of Embarkation.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
That's okay. So, when exactly was this? What month and year?
That would have been, well, it was February when I went to Camp Meade, mm-hmm. and it was March when I went to Patrick Henry.
Okay, so this would be March of 1944?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Tell us what happened next.
Well, I think we were there about, I don't really remember, a week, 10 days, and we were shipped out.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't know where we were going, of course, but we spent, I don't know how we survived it, but we spent 30 days on a Liberty ship going across to Europe. And I did not, of course, know much of where we were, but one of the guys on the ship with us had been an astronomer, and he could tell by reading the stars at night where we were.
Mm-hmm.
And at one time we were off the coast of Florida, and the next time we were out in the mid-Atlantic, actually up in the North Atlantic. That wasn't much fun. Hit a couple of bad storms.
Mm.
And the Liberty ships were not built for storms. Actually, partway across, two of the ships broke in half.
Really?
So
wow.
There were a lot of men lost there. But at any rate, we went on, the mm-hmm. rest of us, the convoy went on. And we dropped part of the convoy off in Sicily, and the other half went up, the half I was with, went up the east coast of Italy. And that was more fun. We then were put on freight cars. and taken across Italy to Naples. Mm-hmm. I think it took us, I don't remember whether it was 2 or 3 days in a freight mm-hmm. car. Wasn't the most accommodating, but we did it.
Mm-hmm. Now, in all that time you were traveling, and even before when you were in basic and advanced training, what was the best way you had of keeping up with what was going on in Europe?
We really didn't know anything.
Really?
Uh-huh. Not during that period.
Mm-hmm. So no radio, Stars and Stripes?
None of us had radios.
Mm-hmm. Not even a 60-pound one on your back?
No, thank God I didn't have that.
So now you're in Naples?
Well, from Naples, we actually went to a rest camp. They called it a rest camp. Mm-hmm. It was in Caserta, C-A-S-E-R-T-A. Mm-hmm. That had been the home of some of the royalty from Naples years mm-hmm. before. And at that time, just prior to that, it had been occupied by Mussolini's son-in-law, Count Ciano, mm-hmm. who was also one of his higher officers. Mm-hmm. And that was quite a camp, but there were like 10,000 men there. Mm-hmm. And of course we slept in tents. And I don't know how long before we were then all divided up, depending on which unit needed us the most. Mm-hmm. And that was right after one of the big battles of Italy, the battle on Monte Cassino and the Rapido River. And my outfit, the outfit I was to join, mm-hmm. lost 2,900 men in one night.
Wow.
So they needed replacements, and I was one of the lucky replacements.
So what was the unit you joined?
It was the 36th Texas Division.
Texas?
And that's the T on my hat.
Okay.
Texas Division.
So now you're a rifleman with the 36th Texas?
36th Texas Division.
143rd
mm-hmm. Infantry, Company K.
Okay. Tell us what happened next.
Well, then we had, I think we were probably there about a month mm-hmm. with more training, which some of it was fun. At one point, we were trying to be mule skinners. Mule skinning meaning that when the mules were used to carry whatever they had to, artillery or mm-hmm. weapons or food or whatever, when it got to a point where the mules couldn't go any higher, that's where we came in. So I had a couple of weeks of training there. That was okay. Fun. I had never been that close to a mule in my life.
Well, at least it didn't mean the other thing, like, mule skinning.
Yeah, but we were taught whatever we needed, whatever we might mm-hmm. need to have once we get into battle.
Right.
And I would guess it was about a month. Yeah, about a month. Mm-hmm. And it was very good in a way because I got to know some of the men that had been previously in battle, and I listened to them, and they told me a lot mm-hmm. of how to survive. And that was very important. Mm. We had that time to learn, mm-hmm. and it came in handy.
Okay.
And after that, we were sent up to Anzio Beachhead, A-N-Z-I-O, mm-hmm. And I guess that was about the middle of May. And then it was a touch and go for a couple of weeks. Toward the end of the month, with the advancement that we had made on Anzio, we ran into what really was a roadblock, and they called it, it was the Alban Hills, but it was called Mount Artemisio, Artemisio. And my division commander, General Fred Walker, came up with a plan that made that one of the best battles of the war. He submitted the plan, and Mark Clark, the commanding officer, said, "If this works, it's my idea. If it doesn't work, it's your butt." I should say that after the battle that they had at Monte Cassino and the Rapido River, my division general never got along with Mark Clark. So there was animosity there. But anyhow, the plan was, and I'm amazed when I think about it, one regiment, there's three regiments in the division, one regiment was to stay where they were, forming a frontal attack on the mountain. Mm-hmm. In the meantime, the one or three in another regiment were pulled back, and that night we were told to tape down everything that we wore, including our dog tags, canteen, everything. You could not have a bullet in your rifle to avoid any accidental shooting. And the two regiments went up and around that mountain at night without a sound. And that is really, it made it one of the most unbelievable battles of the war. But with that, when the Germans woke up in the morning, they realized we were behind them. And except for what had, those that had already gone on to Rome, those people had to give up or they were killed.
Amazing.
It was quite a thing.
Do you remember how many Germans were captured?
I really have no idea. I don't have no idea. But and then after that, our division, tanks and all that, the engineers went in, division engineers went in and made roads, and the trucks and jeeps were able to come in with supplies. And with that, that was really I have a book that describes it, but that was the key in the lock to the road to Rome. The main road to Rome was open.
Now, you were mentioning this plan. Were you a part of that plan? Were you climbing up?
I was one of the ones that climbed up around the mountain.
Wow.
Everything, I find it hard to believe now, but everything, including the dog tags, had to be taped together. It was quite a surprise.
Must have been.
Yeah.
All right, so the road to Rome?
The road to Rome is open. So we moved forward. And this is where I get into another difficult part of it. As we were moving forward, my company was assigned to go to a particular place. The town, incidentally, was Velletri, V-E-L-L-E-T-R-Y. And my unit was assigned to go to a certain place. And when we got to that where the company was supposed to be, we could not go there because it was directly under fire. And we had to move over to the left flank. Mm-hmm. That's the left of where we were. And when we began to come under our own artillery fire, we knew we had to get some word back to division to let them know. So my commanding officer apparently called division headquarters, and they said, well, can you send somebody back that can show us where you are? Mm-hmm. And lead us up to you, a forward observer. So, being 18 and naive, and of course the first thing they tell you when you win the service is don't volunteer. Mm-hmm. But I volunteered. And I went back to battalion headquarters and brought a major up. But on the way, we came under shell fire, and I got hit in the left leg.
Mm-hmm. Where in the left leg? Upper?
Right up.
Okay.
Up, mm-hmm. Just above the knee. Yeah. It wasn't a serious wound, but we were able to patch it up with what my first aid kit. And then we took off again, and I finally got the major up to our company. Mm-hmm. And then somehow later they got me back to regimental headquarters to an aid station. In the meantime, my company kept moving forward, mm-hmm. and I was back in the hospital, not badly wounded, but so that I was ambulatory. Mm-hmm. But not ready to join my outfit. And of course, I wasn't the only one. There were several of us. Mm-hmm. And the big question then, because we were moving so fast, what do we do with these guys that really don't belong in the hospital and yet can't go back? Mm-hmm. So somebody had the bright idea, and knowing the Army, where would you put people that have trouble walking, put them out as road guides. So that's what we did. I was, myself and another guy were assigned as road guides outside of the Coliseum to direct traffic.
The Coliseum in Rome?
In Rome. And they said that when our regiment or division came through, they would pick us up. Mm-hmm. Well, their orders got changed, and they never came through. So that left, I still don't know whatever happened to the other guy. He happened to be Jewish, and he met up with some Roman Jews. And I guess he took off with them, I don't know. Uh-huh. But I was there, and I stayed there for 2 days. And finally, the division MPs came through, and they were directing traffic. And I told them, they said, well, if they told you to stay here, stay here. Well, I couldn't do that. I mean, 3 days, I knew there was something wrong. Mm-hmm. So I took off and headed down. I had heard, actually, I'd met a monk who was a messenger from his order to the Vatican. And he told me that the Americans were going to have an audience with the Pope the next day. And I said, well, I'm not going to miss that. And I that night I went to a barber shop, hoping that I could get cleaned up a little bit. They were very nice to me, but they said, clean yourself up. They let me go in and wash up and shampoo, and finally they shaved and gave me a haircut. I gave them some canned rations that we had, canned cheese. I thought that'd be great. They couldn't even melt it in their oven. But they were good to me.
Okay.
And the next day I went to the Vatican. I had the audience with the Pope. Of course, there were thousands of us there. And I had served Mass for that Pope, Pius XII. He had been in Boston as a cardinal at the cathedral where I was head altar boy. So I served Mass for him as a cardinal.
No fooling, wow.
And of course, I never got a chance to renew that friendship. But that's another story. So I was left alone. I knew I had to rejoin my outfit somehow. And I still don't know how I did it. But by asking around, I found out about where they were and which direction they had taken, and I hitchhiked a ride when I could, or walked when I had to. I finally caught up with them. I don't know how far north of Rome they were, but I caught up with them. They didn't expect me, because on their books I was part of regimental headquarters. They really didn't expect me, but anyhow, I caught up with them and I rejoined the outfit there.
Okay. Let's step back a little bit. As far as the hospital care you received is concerned, was it adequate?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
And the hospital was fine. But it was only a temporary, it wasn't a real hospital anyhow. It was a temporary, I would almost call it a dispensary. They always had a large hospital in the rear. And they didn't have time. No, didn't have time to fool around with a little injured knee. So that was why they shipped us out.
And secondly, given that you were in right in front of the Colosseum directing traffic and visiting a barber shop in Rome, I take it you had some dealings with the locals.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I was able to speak enough Italian. And as a matter of fact, the monk I met spoke a little English, but he also spoke French. And of course, I was very good in Latin, and I had had a couple of years of French, so I could talk to him in both Latin and French and English. And so I got along pretty well with him.
Good. So overall, at this point, your experiences in Italy, while a little rough at times, was okay?
Overall, I wouldn't say I was mistreated.
And what was your rank at the time?
Private.
You were still a private, okay. Now you're back with your old outfit. Tell us what happened next.
Well, they continued to drive forward. The Germans were evacuating pretty fast. They wanted to get back up to the line they had up by Florence. And so they were moving backward fast. And we moved forward. And one night on the drive, my squad of the company I was with was sent out on patrol. And that was an experience. We heard, here we are on patrol to find the Germans, and we heard a German patrol coming toward us. Well, we didn't know how many there were of them or how well equipped they were. So we were happened to be right near a house that had a little courtyard. And we went into the courtyard and laid down behind the hedges. And when the Germans came marching by or walking by, we were so close, I could have reached out and grabbed the boot. Mm-hmm. That was a little mm-hmm. nerve-wracking, mm-hmm. but we did it. Mm-hmm. But when the Germans went by us, then we heard all the fire, and my company were able to intercept them, and that was the end of that.
Wow.
So that was a lucky break. Another time, again, we were out on patrol, and we got heavily pinned down by machine gun fire and everything. And the squad leader hollered for the four of us that were in the back of the squad to go back and get help from the company. Well, you really have to understand the Army was so screwed up. Nobody knew where they were going anyhow. And by the time we got back to where the company was supposed to be, we were pinned down a couple of times on the way. By the time we got back to where the company was supposed to be, they were gone. So here now there's four of us completely on our own. And we went back to where we had left our squad the day before. Four or five of them were dead. Mm-hmm. We just had to take off looking for our outfit. And we did. And we kept going. And again, I don't know how we did it. I know that we were able to hitchhike with some outfits that were moving up. One time, we hitched a ride on a Jeep with a couple of Air Force officers. They were driving up to see the damage that they had done with the airplanes. Mm. So they gave us a ride. Well, there were two of them and four of us. Well, we couldn't all fit in the Jeep. So I sat on top of the gas can, which is not a very good place to sit. No place to hold on to. Mm-hmm. And they happened to hit a bomb crater.
Oh, dear.
And he was going a good 30 miles an hour. Well, I went flying off the back end. When they came to pick me up, and thank God I had my steel helmet on, or I think I'd have really got hurt. I was covered in dust, and I mean dust. And from that time on, my nickname became Dusty. But we continued on, crazy. One night we put up in a barn, and I killed one of the geese that was there, and we tried to cook that over an open fire. I had learned how to do that when we raised chickens at home. Mm-hmm. But we kept on going until we found ourselves in a little town called Piombino. And what we did not find out until after we contacted some of the people, the town was occupied by the Germans. We were now, four of us, behind the German lines.
Oh, dear.
And that was not a comfortable place to be. But one of the guys with us spoke Italian, so he communicated with the people, and they agreed to put us up. And they did. They hit us out. And in the morning, the women would go down to church, and they would come back and tell us whether the Germans were still in town or not. And as long as they were in town, we just hid out in the house. And finally, the Germans had to leave the town, mm-hmm. And by then the Americans came in, and once again, we caught up with our outfit. And I don't remember how we did all of that. It was a crazy period.
Mm-hmm.
But the whole thing was a crazy period. And shortly after we rejoined the outfit around Florence, we were ordered to go back to the Naples area. They were shipped back to Naples. And the idea was to get us then ready for another battle. And we were so depleted then that we needed other reinforcements. So we were sent back to Naples, back to Salerno, where mm-hmm. they had actually made the invasion. And we took a lot of amphibious training there, mm-hmm. knowing that our next battle was going to be an amphibious landing, where we had no idea.
Mm-hmm.
We finally found out by the end of the first week in August,
mm-hmm.
we then began to move onto ships. And then we were headed for where we didn't know.
Okay.
Wound up, we were off the coast of southern France. And that was a big armada of ships. We had heavy air cover. I know because one of my cousins was flying one of the planes that covered us.
Mm-hmm.
One of my other cousins was on the battleship Texas, which escorted us in. So we were well protected by my relatives.
Oh.
And I didn't mind that out, of course, till after the war.
Mm-hmm.
But anyhow, the morning of August 15th, we made the invasion in southern France. And there were three divisions that went in. The 3rd, the 45th were off to our right flank. And we were supposed to go in on three different beaches, red, green, and blue, I guess. So one regiment was supposed to go in on Red Beach. We were on Green Beach, and the other Blue Beach.
Mm-hmm.
We went in on Green Beach without too much difficulty. There was some firing, but we were able to overcome that. When we got in a little ways, there was more firing, and we called the air cover, and they came. And I would not want to be caught under our own airplanes. The mountain shook, and I mean it shook. And here we are just laying on the ground watching it. But anyhow, they silenced the guns and we moved forward.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I don't know if I mentioned, I was an interpreter for the outfit. I had volunteered, to be an interpreter because of my 3 years of French.
Mm-hmm.
And we came across a group of Germans that were hidden out in an underground area near a farmhouse. The French people in the farm told us that they were there and they wanted to surrender.
Mm-hmm.
So we went up and we accepted them, had to send them back to the rear. But I took a pair of binoculars off of the captain that was there, the German captain. I thought they might come in handy. know, I took those. And we went on further, and we, from there on, we made out pretty well. Mm-hmm. At night, we were ordered, because the other regiment could not go in on Red Beach, we were ordered to make a turn and come down to relieve the pressure on them and go through the town. And that was when we were going down into the town of San Rafael, S-A-N-R-A-F-A-E-L, San Rafael. Mm-hmm. Well, we're going into the town, fairly quiet. Was getting to be, I would say, around 8:30, 9 o'clock at night. It was just, you know, summer nights, getting dark. Mm-hmm. And we came to a fork in the road, and the one squad was on the left side of the street, another squad on the right side of the street, and at the end of the fork was a German tank. Mm-hmm. And that was not good news. When they heard us coming, they were waiting, and they fired when we got to the crossroad. They fired when we got out in the open. Well, I happened to be on the left side of the street, mm-hmm. so I was fortunate to jump behind a tree. Well, when they shot the cannon off, here we were about 30 feet from the cannon.
Oh boy.
Well, that was quite a shot. And there were 10 of us hit with one shell. 2 of us survived.
Oh my. Yeah.
But I went back to the hospital, well, an aid station. The odd thing, on the way into the town, we had met some of the town's people and asked them if we had to, could we use their home as an aid station? Mm-hmm. And they said, sure. And they had set up a room in the basement of one of the houses. So without realizing it, I was taken back to their house. When I was hit, I was only hit in the jaw. But I had a fractured jaw and a concussion, slight concussion. I really was out of it. Mm-hmm. I don't remember going back to the aid station, but I was taken back to the aid station. And there I found the rest of my men that had survived were there. One of them was my lieutenant. And he was very badly wounded. Mm-hmm. We knew he wasn't going to make it. And the only thing I remember there, after they had bandaged me up, he had serious stomach injury. And of course he wanted water, which he could not have. But I asked one of the medics, and they said, well, you can soak some gauze in water and let them suck on that. Mm-hmm. And that's what we did. I helped him out the best I could. Well, the next morning, by then, some of the jeeps had come in, and the aid station we had were warned that the Germans might try to come back. So we better evacuate. And they put the worst of the wounded on stretchers, taped them across the jeeps, one on the back, one on the front. And the walking wounded, we rode along as shotguns. And I actually carried my rifle back, even though Geneva Convention and said, no, we were doing what we had to do. And we were taken back to a hospital that they had set up on the beach. Mm-hmm. And from there, I was very well taken care of. Matter of fact, I think, if I remember correctly, the wound in my jaw, actually, there was a flap of skin, and it was the top and the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a German doctor that we had captured that day, and he was helping out in our hospital, because there were German prisoners there too.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he helped bandage me up, took out whatever shrapnel he could and bandaged me up. But he was smart. He put a pin in here and a pin in here.
Mm-hmm.
And the flap never left his scar. The only thing I have are little pin marks.
You never notice it.
So we went back, we were taken back then by hospital ship to Naples. And from there, that it became a hectic story from there.
Mm-hmm.
At one point I was being retrained. They were going to send me back to combat. And I came down with an attack of malaria. My first attack of malaria. So I had to go to the hospital. When I come out of the hospital, they sent me to another replacement camp. And while they were trying to decide what to do with me, I came down with another attack of malaria. So back to the hospital. Then I went to another replacement camp, and they were going to train me in typing. They were going to reclassify me as a clerk typist, which was all right. I knew a little typing anyhow.
Mm-hmm.
Halfway through that, I had another attack of malaria. So that was the end of that. When I got to the general hospital, they kept me there, and they finally decided, let's send him home.
And where was the general?
I think I was too much trouble with the army then.
And where was this general hospital?
In a general hospital, okay. in Naples.
Okay.
Yeah. Actually, that was quite a place. It was an area that Mussolini and Hitler had earmarked. They were going to have the World's Fair there after they won the war.
Hmm.
So it was quite a large area, mm-hmm. with a lot of buildings and everything. And of course we converted them all to hospitals. But it was quite a nice area.
Mm-hmm.
And I was able to get into Naples, saw a lot of Naples,
mm-hmm.
then finally shipped home.
And when was this?
I left Naples around the middle of February. No, it must have been the end of February. I landed back in New York on March 10th. Went to, I forget what camp I went to. I don't remember what camp I went to. But from there, we were allowed to go home on furlough.
Mm-hmm.
And I had orders then, after my furlough, to report to Camp Edwards,
mm-hmm.
down the Cape. So I went home on a month's leave. I was only home 2 weeks. I had another attack of malaria.
Mm-hmm.
So they said the Red Cross took me down to the hospital at Camp Edwards. And I stayed there. I got an extension on my leave. Went back home for a couple of weeks. Back to Camp Edwards. Stayed there, waiting to be discharged. This is April, and here we are, every week they told us we're going to be discharged. Well, it never came. Well, finally, and this is something you never hear of in the Army, but I don't know who started it, but a gang went on strike. We refused to do anything. Wouldn't do a thing. Wouldn't all out or formation, nothing. And of course the word spread. Well, nobody would do it. The idea was that with the 4th of July coming up, we knew that the officers would be given a pass, if not a discharge. Why weren't we? So the word finally got to the commandant of the camp, and he canceled all orders of the officers. None of them would go home on the 4th of July until we were discharged. So I was discharged on the morning of the 4th of July, 11 o'clock in the morning.
Happy birthday, America, and happy civilian life to you.
But that wasn't the end of the story.
Go ahead.
One little bit more.
Okay.
I figured I was all through in the Army. My father, having been a World War I veteran, was the commander of the VFW post in Hingham. He had started that post. He was a commander. And who do you think was assigned to lead the parade on the 4th of July? Me. When he told me that, I did. And that was the end of it.
Wow.
And that was the end of my story.
Mm-hmm.
A long time. What have we been here? An hour and a half?
Oh, at least. But tell us what happened after you got discharged. Your epilogue, so to speak.
So I did all I could.
Mm-hmm. How
but
would,
like it says here on the hat, all gave some gave all.
Mm-hmm.
And the real heroes were the ones that never came back. Mm. You know, I was even telling my sons today that when the combat badge came out, you know, at first you only got the rifle. And after 30 days in combat, you'd get the wreath. They began to realize a lot of the guys didn't make it 30 days.
Mm-hmm.
And so then they decided they all earned mm-hmm. the wreath.
Now, what awards and commendations did you receive?
Well, I have the...
Your two Purple Hearts.
The Bronze Star.
Uh-huh.
And two Purple Hearts.
Yeah.
And the Combat Infantry.
Okay. Now...
And a Presidential Unit Citation.
Okay. Tell us a little bit about the citation.
Well, the first Purple Heart, I was in the hospital in Naples,
mm-hmm.
and the colonel that gave them out, I was in a bed in the hospital. The colonel that was giving out the Purple Hearts really could care less. He had been a retread from World War I, old, disillusioned, and he threw them here. This and a dime will get you a cup of coffee.
Oh,
I had no citation with the Purple Heart.
Mm-hmm. Well, what about the Presidential Unit Citation?
That came, I don't think I ever got that on in paper.
Mm-hmm.
That was given to the whole unit.
Mm-hmm.
But with the second Purple Heart, I did get, and that, no, I didn't get a commendation with that either.
Hmm.
And the Bronze Star I do have on paper.
Mm-hmm.
That was awarded and engraved. Not this one, but mailed to me.
Okay. And what did you get the Bronze Star for?
For having helped out at up the Anzio, mm-hmm. when I brought that major up to our outfit. And that was something I did not have to do, mm-hmm. and it was something that helped the whole outfit.
Okay.
And
what did you do after the war? What kind of career did you have?
Actually, and I was talking to the man that we just came from the museum, mm-hmm. and I don't know how much contact you have had with combat veterans, but if anybody has seen combat, mm-hmm. they'll tell you when they came home, they were crazy. And we were just not ready to fit into civilian life. Today they call it post-traumatic stress disorder, and I think that's a wonderful term. Mm-hmm. This, I don't know, what, in the World War I, they said they were shell-shocked. World War II, we were psycho. Mm-hmm. Now they have a correct name for it. Well, anyhow, to answer your question, after a few months, or immediately, and this was something, I had a job waiting on me up in Poland Spring, Maine, mm-hmm. at the caddy camp. They were expecting I'd be discharged early. So they were holding a job on me as caddy master. And so I was only home 3 or 4 days, mm-hmm. and I went up to Maine. And that was good. In a way, I was able to adjust to, again, I was away from home, but I was able to adjust to being in a new world. Mm-hmm. And it was that summer that the airplane hit the Empire State Building. Mm. I don't know if you boys have heard about that.
I remember it.
Halfway up the Empire State Building. And I was at Poland Spring at the time. And so I was at Poland Spring all summer. Partway through the summer, I had to come back to Boston for a reason. And that happened to be VJ Day. So I went into Boston with one of my girlfriends at the time. And we had a celebration. Mm-hmm. And then I decided I was going to college. Mm-hmm. And I enrolled in Boston College. And they did have a good group of veterans. They started what they called a matriculation program. Mm-hmm. And it was all veterans. And we all fit in pretty well together. But I still could not settle down. And mm-hmm. I did all right in my studies, but I wasn't ready to be cooped up in a classroom and somebody lecturing to me. So I quit after one semester. I quit. Mm-hmm. And then I had the bright idea. My family, in the meantime, had moved to Hingham during the war. And I had the bright idea. There was only 2 taxis in the town of Hingham. And my mother said they could use another taxi. So I went down and I applied for a taxi permit. Well, the town was very willing to give it to me because, first of all, when I went down to the town before that, because they were advertising job placement for veterans, they offered me a job digging graves. I said, no, I've had enough of that. So finally, when I went down and asked for a permit to get a cab, I got it. Mm-hmm. And I kept the cab business for 3 years. I did very well. Bought myself a limousine, a used one. And I did pretty well in those 3 years. But I got tired of that and decided to give it up. went down to Florida. I went looking for a job down there, and I found out that there was a nightclub nearby. They were looking for parking attendants. Mm-hmm. Well, fine. I went home and I got a job as a parking attendant. It wasn't until later I found out that the club was owned by the Jewish Mafia.
Hmm.
Maya Lansky.
Mm-hmm.
L-A-N-S-K-Y.
Mm-hmm.
I became pretty good. Actually, I became a pretty good friend of his.
Mm-hmm.
I got along pretty well with him. And eventually, I worked my way up from being just a parking attendant to being an assistant doorman. And one night, the doorman got a message that he had to leave. The FBI was after him.
Oh, dear. Okay.
So he had to leave. He and his wife left. And it was near the end of the season, so they made me doorman,
mm-hmm.
which was good. Except I saw a lot more of what went on than maybe I should have. Mm. And that's when Maya Lansky and I became friends.
Mm-hmm.
As he knew what I saw, I did not see. And I would not talk about what I could not see.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not even going to talk about it. But at the end of the season, they had another place in Peekskill, New York, New Jersey. It's right over the bridge from New York.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And they invited me to go back there with them. And I kind of thought about it, but one of the Mafia, another guy I got to know pretty well. I don't know what he was, what he had done in the past. That was something else. But he took me aside and he said, John, don't ever come back. They'll kill you. And I said, that was enough. So I did not do. I came back to Boston and I went to college.
Mm-hmm. Did you go back to Boston College or did
no,
you?
No, I went to Boston University.
Uh-huh.
And I got 3 degrees there, associate, bachelor's, and mm-hmm. master's. And then I taught for 35 years.
Mm-hmm. What did you teach?
Social sciences.
Okay. High school level?
Junior high.
Junior high. Where in junior high? What
Quincy.
Town? Quincy. Okay. Did you join any veterans organizations?
I joined the VFW, naturally, because mm-hmm. of my father.
Right.
And the DAV.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a lifetime member of the VFW,
mm-hmm.
still belong.
Have you received any veterans benefits such as hospitalization or a GI Bill?
Well, I had the GI Bill, naturally.
Right.
Actually, I did not use the GI Bill.
Mm-hmm.
It was what they call Public Law 16.
Mm-hmm.
346, I think, was the GI Bill.
Mm-hmm.
I was on PL 16 for disabled vets, which meant that in addition to tuition, I got all my books paid for, and I got a stipend, monthly stipend.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
that was good.
Have you ever attended any reunions with your old outfit?
One was not an official reunion because it was held in New York rather than in Texas.
Mm-hmm.
And that was, I think, in either 1947 or 48,
mm-hmm.
They had made a movie called Go for Broke, which mm-hmm. was about mm-hmm. the 442, the Japanese Americans. And they fought alongside of us and with mm-hmm. us and were very close to us.
Uh-huh.
As a matter of fact, at one time up in northern France, one of our battalions was surrounded, and it was the 442 that went in and released them.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
And they were excellent soldiers.
Mm-hmm.
That's something I left out maybe in my story, but
that's okay.
Mm-hmm. They were great men, mm-hmm. great men. So anyhow, when they were having their movie, the world premiere of the movie, we decided that would be a good opportunity for us to join with them.
Mm-hmm.
So we had a reunion in New York.
Mm.
And that was good. I saw some of the guys.
Nice. Did you ever keep up with any of your old buddies?
No. No, never mm-hmm. able to.
Mm-hmm.
Well, at one time, I had started an association of our unit for Massachusetts veterans. And we had 3 or 4 meetings, but then it kind of petered out. The guys, I think it was too soon. A lot of the guys, first of all, didn't want to come into Boston for a meeting, and
mm-hmm.
I don't know, it never really took off the ground.
Okay. How important to you was serving in the military?
How?
Important.
Well, when I look back, I'm glad I was a part of it.
Mm-hmm.
I think I have to say I'm happy with the educational benefits I got as a veteran, because my family sure as heck never would have been able to afford it.
Mm-hmm.
I was the only only college graduate of my family. So,
mm-hmm.
And I'm still on disability, so I'm still getting a monthly check from them.
Okay.
Providing we don't have a government shutdown.
John, is there anything else you would like to say?
Nothing except I'm very happy to be home and happy with the family I have.
Mm-hmm. Well, John P. Hayes, Sr., thank you so much for coming in and taking part in the Natick Veterans Oral History Project.
Well, this has been a wonderful interview. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm.